Dr. Varshavski, thank you so much for joining me to talk about coronavirus and social media and a whole bunch of other things.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it. These are all topics I'm very passionate about, and I've been advocating on my social media, especially heavily over the last few months.
So let's just start maybe by your introducing yourself to our audience. Tell me how you spend your weeks.
Yeah, I'm a board certified family medicine physician, and my clinical role has never changed since I finished my residency training. I'm working half of the week seeing patients in a primary care office setting. It's really a community health center where we're treating a lot of folks who are underinsured or uninsured, so constantly dealing with the difficulties of navigating through our complex healthcare system. And then the rest of the week, I spend time putting out informative videos either on my YouTube channel, engaging in dialogue on Twitter, writing blog posts for the American Academy of Family Physicians, or doing television, because I try and utilize every possible media outlet to spread the message of good evidence-based medicine, because during a time like this, we need it more than ever.
Great. So as a clinician, you're a generalist. You see all kinds of people, all kinds of conditions.
Yeah, exactly. So I can have a one-year-old or a 101-year-old come through my door for any condition. A lot of times it's a mystery what that condition is, but I will tell you that a huge component to my practice has been mental health focused, especially during the time of this pandemic, where you're seeing physical manifestations from the anxiety that's been really not only incited, but then even raised to the highest degree because of quarantine, staying at home, political polarization, and all these other challenges my patients are facing.
Got it. And then on social media and all these different interviews, you're also a bit of a generalist. Would that be fair to say?
Yeah, I think so. Because, you know, as a family medicine physician, I have to be ready to talk about any subject. I have to be up to date on my research. And that's really what I see myself as, because I'm not a specific expert in any one of these given fields. I'm an expert in understanding what questions patients have, how they communicate, how they best receive this information. And then I know where to get the quality info, what to look for in a journal article, how to communicate that journal article to someone with perhaps not the highest health literacy. And I've become really passionate about delivering that message.
Can you walk me through the different channels that you use for that kind of work? And, you know, when we're talking about you're reaching people, how many people are you reaching?
My YouTube platform, I have 6 million subscribers, or at least really close to it.
Did you just say 6 million subscribers?
Yeah. And that's just over 3 years of doing YouTube. We have 600 million views across our channel. And when I say our channel, it's really me and my videographer. That's it. That's my team. A lot of people think I have a major team behind me, you know, production staff. Nope. Me and one other person. I'm coming up with two ideas every week to talk about. One on Wednesday, which is more of a media focused video, talking about the trending topic of that week. And then Sunday, I like to have a little fun, because that's really a great way to get people involved, to listen, to learn about their health without making it feel stuffy and boring and like they're inside of a classroom. Because at the end of the day, in order to get millions of views on a video, I can't just strictly be talking about dense, hardcore data. It's very difficult to get a general public to tune into that type of video. So I really managed to find this healthy balance between entertainment and education in a format I like to call edutainment.
Got it. So like, how does that work? Like take a recent topic and
explain. Yeah. So, for example, people love watching medical dramas, Grey's Anatomy of the world, Good Doctor of the world. These are huge shows, millions of viewers week in and week out for 16 years now. And I thought it would be a great idea for a doctor to watch these shows and critique what's happening in them. Because so many times a patient would be in my practice, admitted under my care, and they would have misconceptions about what is going to happen to them, about the care they're going to receive, who's going to be part of their care team. Like, these shows don't show nursing, the nursing staff as part of the care of the patients at all. It looks like the doctors are doing everything, starting the IVs, taking them to the radiology suite, this and that, and it's not reality. So I would watch these shows, I would give my critique, show how it's not all about romance and drama in the hospital, and in the midst of it, critique the medical accuracy of the shows. Is the way they're treating the pneumothorax correct? Are they missing doing chest compressions when someone collapses and their heart stops and they call code blue? Because everyone assumes that if someone's heart stops, it's about shocking them. And constantly on my channel, I'm saying chest compressions, chest compressions, chest compressions. So I'm mixing this known entity with something unknown.
Got it. And I'm sure you're getting a lot of good information across. How do you do that on something like COVID-19, where, you know, that's not yet an episode on those shows? You know, they can't even record those shows.
Yeah, so I found unique ways to talk about COVID-19 using other shows that have quarantine episodes. For example, Scrubs had a quarantine episode. It was actually about the SARS virus, so not SARS-CoV-2 in this case, but a lot of similarities there, explaining the differences between the quarantine they were doing versus the one we're doing now. I've also talked about things you could be doing at home to keep your mental health up, to focus on social interactions, because a lot of people think physical distancing equals social isolation. And that's not the case, and it shouldn't be the case.
Right.
So constantly showing people ways that you can have fun during quarantine, to stay fit, to stay sharp, those types of content is really powerful for viewers to want to get engaged with. So, and I've also been lucky to have some amazing guests on my channel, from the vice president of Google Health to Dr. Fauci. Mm-hmm. Even came on my channel, and that video has 6 million views, where we just sat around and talked for 20 minutes about COVID-19.
Wow. So it sounds like you're taking your observation from your clinical practice that there are a lot of stressors in COVID-19 and thinking about how to give people some tools to address them in your social media work.
Yeah, for sure. Not only stressors, but also the amount of confusion that stems from the misinformation out there. I even partnered up with the United Nations. They had a campaign 2 weeks ago called Pause and Take Care Before You Share, because it's really easy to see something pop up on social media that triggers your emotional reasoning, that right in that moment, you want to send it out to all of your subscribers or all of your fans or friends. And if you just take that moment and you just take that little pause, that shifts you from that quick thinking, lizard brain thinking of, I got to share this because it makes me feel a specific way, to, oh, let me think about this critically. And right. It's a matter of that 5 seconds that can make the difference between misinformation thriving or not.
Got it. Now, do you have interaction with the people who are looking at your videos online? Do they post comments? Do you, you know, kind of get a sense of where they're coming from? Or is it all one way, what you think would be helpful to them?
Well, it's socially isolating for myself as an individual, because at the end of the day, I'm just speaking to a camera, not to millions of people. So you do forget that your videos have a major impact on the world, major impact on people's actions that they're going to take for their health and the health of their family members. But then, because social media is a tool for communication, there's comments. I could see what people's thought processes are. There's like and dislike buttons. There's a community that I formed on Reddit, and that's going to be expanding soon, where there's a forum for discussion on video topics, ideas for the future, things that are coming out that are confusing my viewers. And I really draw a lot of influence from that, because I think it needs to be a two-way conversation, just how patient-doctor relationship should be a two-way conversation, the same way that I treat my viewers.
So as you're hearing things from your viewers, what do you think the main sources of confusion are, or the main points of confusion?
I think there's a level of fear, because there's so much unknown with this virus. And I think media has really done a poor job in A, informing people with accurate info, and then B, just scaring the life out of them in the beginning, especially this pandemic, with constant outbreak warnings, constant fear, threat levels, all of that, that I think really served to the negative influence of society. And now, with the rise of political polarization on top of it, what I think has been lost is trust. And trust is one of the most important factors for a healthy collaboration. And any venture, whether we're talking about healthcare, political, legal, it needs collaboration. The reason why I think our healthcare system is such a mess is because doctors, physicians who are actually treating patients have largely been excluded from these conversations. And I think that media has done a huge disservice in dividing us, uninforming us, because they're sometimes putting out info that's not accurate, putting on experts that are questionable, simply because it draws viewerships or clicks. And right. I feel like my channel has filled the void for people who want honest, unbiased information, who just want the facts to make the best decisions for themselves and their families.
So people come to your site thinking that, you know, masks are just a, you know, political scam to get people to cover their faces, or that the virus is just like the flu. You know, how do you go about redirecting them? You know, I think this is a question that we get a lot, you know, from listeners and students who are having these difficult conversations with people who can be very hard to move off their positions.
I think it has to come first from a place of understanding and empathy. If you want to change someone's mind, you also have to gain their respect. You have to be likable. And this is just human psychology. This isn't my thoughts. These are experts that have studied this for decades. And through my YouTube channel, I'm able to understand where people are coming from, understand where that confusion stems from, and really attack it at its foundation, as opposed to just saying, no, masks are just a political ploy and yelling, like a lot of people want to do, because that's what it feels like we should be doing. But that's not going to change anyone's mind. Even when we talk about the subject of vaccines, you know, there's people that come to my channel that are very vaccine hesitant. They're not anti-vaccine, but they're worried because their parents, they don't have a medical background to know what a quality research article is. So they see something scary, they get hesitant, and they make bad decisions for their family members. So I feel by me not necessarily combating and battling anti-vaxxers, simply just putting out my reasoning for why vaccines work, my reasoning for why there's a level of humility in medicine, why we don't always get things right. Now suddenly there's a trustworthy source that's relatable, that's honest, that you see in week in and week out, because that also plays a role in influence. That's why celebrities have such huge power in marketing and advertising. If a celebrity comes out and gives a bad piece of medical advice, people take it seriously simply because they're familiar to so many viewers. So I'm hoping that my YouTube and social media influence can play that same role, but for good evidence-based medicine.
So people are checking in with your channel or whichever channel they're seeing you regularly. Yeah. They know you're going to be there and they can have some confidence that they can hear good information from you.
Exactly. And you know, it's a huge responsibility that you're the source. Meanwhile, I'm just one person. You know, I'm reading quality sources day in and day out to make sure I'm as up to date as possible. But you know, everyone's susceptible to making mistakes. You know, we as a medical community initially saw masks as something that wouldn't benefit people during the time of COVID-19. And the reasoning that we had was sound. And as we learned more, we changed our reasoning based on the evidence. This was all very logical. Right. But unless you're in our shoes, as a viewer, you can get quite confused. Why are doctors constantly flip-flopping? Right. I mean, how many times have we said coffee is bad for your health, then good for your health? How many times have we said wine is heart healthy, it's not heart healthy? It's confusing unless you explain your rationale for why you're making these decisions.
And being there time and again helps you maintain a bond with people that they're willing to listen if you're changing your mind. So sounds like having Dr. Fauci was a highlight for you on the show.
Yeah, I mean, that was huge. You know, Dr. Fauci's the respectable figure of the moment who's been doing a fantastic job of staying unbiased during a very politically motivated time, being very respectful, even though attacks are coming his way, and approaching it with a level of humility. I feel like that's lost in medicine and in the political sphere, media sphere. People just think whatever they're saying must be 100% right. That's not the case. And I feel Dr. Fauci approaches each situation with that level of humility that we really desperately need in our country and also the world.
I agree with you. What other highlights come to mind from the various interviews or sessions that you've done?
Yeah, I actually did a video where right at the beginning of the pandemic, I was able to interview 107 physicians, all different specialties, all different backgrounds, ethnicities. They all had very different, unique experiences about COVID-19, with COVID-19. And then they came together to help me make this video, sharing how physicians, what gives them hope. And it was such a moving and powerful video because it really told the story of how unified we are on the health front. Because you look at some of these media channels and it looks like doctors are constantly in disagreement, when here's a perfect example of 106 doctors that look nothing alike, that practice different types of medicine, and yet we're all sharing the same message. I think it was a powerful example of unity in our space, and we're able to raise almost $100,000 for the CDC Foundation because of that video.
Wow, that's tremendous. Talk to me a little bit more about social media, good and bad. I mean, you're out there trying to use the tools of social media for good, help people understand things better. You know, you can also look at social media as spreading so much information. Even compared to your millions of views, there are many, many millions of views of people who are saying things that aren't true or really trying to, you know, almost in some cases, deliberately use the pandemic to divide people. How do you think about that? And what are the responsibilities of media companies to distinguish between the kind of information you're putting out and what might otherwise be available?
Yeah, both really good questions. I think the media companies, I'll start with that, they owe a level of responsibility to make sure that they're putting some level of control on the accuracy of the content, because at the end of the day, they want to put out accurate info. They don't want to spur misinformation. And I'm actually working day in and day out with these platforms to help them figure out what the right way of doing that is. Because, you know, you can rely on one major medical organization, but at the same time, medical organizations make mistakes too. The WHO recently had a misquote in the media of them saying that asymptomatic spread is quite rare, never happens. Then people got really confused about masks when they were really just saying that asymptomatic spread is rare, but pre-symptomatic spread happens all the time. To the average person, there's no difference between asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic. So, you know, major organizations make mistakes all the time, but I think media companies need to step up, continue figuring out ways to battle this misinformation. But then I look at what's my job as a family physician. I think because doctors have been so hesitant and afraid to involve themselves in social media of the fear of being labeled unprofessional, they've allowed misinformation to thrive. Social media is not going anywhere. It's a new technology that people utilize day in and day out. And our absence, the absence of quality physicians online, has really fed into this whole era of misinformation. So I think the more we can be there, the better we can become as communicators, the more empathetic we can become, the better chance we have at battling this misinformation. Because just, you know, villainizing it, that's not a solution. That's not going to get us anywhere. At least I don't think.
Right. Well, I find that, you know, if I tweet something, then my mother and her two closest friends who follow me on Twitter, they get the message pretty directly. sometimes if I don't tweet, then I hear from my mom, what's going on? Everything okay?
Yeah. You
know. I guess that maybe does, though, lead to a question, which is, let's just say with some degree of understatement that not every doctor can be like Dr. Mike. You know, you have an ability clearly to engage at a level that is really remarkably effective in getting people to want to listen to you. But what can other health professionals, public health professionals do other than sit on the sidelines and just wonder what's happening on social media?
Not every doctor can be a trauma surgeon. Not every doctor can be an OBGYN physician. Not every doctor can be a psychiatrist. It doesn't mean that you have to give up medicine altogether. So I think you have to find the role that fits best for you during this pandemic. And for some, that could mean clinical research. For some, that could mean helping elevate voices who are doing great work. You know, part of what makes social media algorithms unique is you can boost up content based on the power of numbers. So it'd be nice to see major medical organizations do a better job on social media so they can prop up our voices. To me, it makes no sense why myself as a recent graduate of a residency program, I'm only 3 years into being an attending, why I have 10x or even 20x the following that the CDC does online when they have unlimited budgets and I'm one person. So I think we need to figure out our own strengths, figure out where we can contribute within this complex healthcare system and understand that there's value in this. And it doesn't mean that every doctor has to start a YouTube channel. Doesn't mean every doctor has to be on a podcast, but there's always something that we can do to either educate ourselves, boost up the voices who are authoritative and doing great work, or just participate in the process as a viewer. As a doctor, if you click on a piece of content and you watch it, that will tell the algorithm that this should be shared. There's an authority score behind these algorithms. And the more we can support our colleagues who are doing great work, the more that we can put out a meaningful message.
Well, thank you so much for taking time from all the different things that you're doing and all the important work to give us a sense of you know, what the world is like out there in social media and how important it is to engage.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for the opportunity. I never thought I would be a family medicine doctor that would be laughing at medical memes on YouTube and actually educating folks with it. But I think thinking outside of the box has served me well, so I encourage your listeners to do the same.